explain to people who don't already know, how did this whole thing start for you? Like, how did this whole journey start with you just being, you weren't initially interested in this story at all. You just kind of like came, stumbled across this job.
I didn't even
want
to do it, I was freelancing. You know, I'd moved out to LA for what I thought was going to be 2 years, sublet my place in New York, was going to go back the following, like 6 months later. My editor, who I'd written with at another magazine that we had all left, it was called Us Magazine, it's still around. It used to be an entertainment magazine that was mostly about motion pictures, music, and TV. And Jan Wenner, who owned it, and Rolling Stone, had decided to make it much more tabloidy. Reality TV was just starting, and he wanted us to do stories about the Kardashians or reality people. Mm. So all of us at the magazine let our contracts go and quit, and they all went to Premiere Magazine, all the people who I worked for. So she said, you should come over with us, but you got to do one great piece here. And she said, the anniversary of the Tate LaBianca murders are coming up in August. This was March. And she said, do a story on it. I'm like, a story on what? And she goes, read the book, you'll find an angle. I go, oh, come on, Leslie. I go, number one, I've never read the book. Hasn't it been written to death? And I didn't say that, you know, to be funny. I didn't realize it till after I said it. And I just said, there's nothing about that that interests me. And she said, well, it's what I got for you right now. And I know you need the money because I hadn't worked for a few months. And she said, here's something I'll tell you. Now that I put his name into your head, you're going to realize that you hear him reference sometimes every day. She said, I hear he's always, you know, compared to the most evil person in the world, described as a metaphor for evil, popular culture, news. And sure enough, all of a sudden I'm hearing, seeing his name in newspapers just as a descriptive, like an adjective or something. So I agreed to do it, and it was supposed to be a 3-month job. And I read Helter Skelter, and I circled stuff or noted stuff that seemed a little bit, you know, something that I thought could be explored a little more. And there were lots of stuff that Bugliosi, who was the author, Vince Bugliosi, and also the prosecutor who convicted the Manson family group in the trial in 70 and 71. There was a lot of stuff I could kind of go along with, but I'm like, Leslie, this is so amorphous. I don't know how. And she said, once you start, you'll find an angle. You always do. I've been working with her for like 15 years in the magazine business, and mm-hmm. she was always my editor, and we thought alike, and she was great. So she said, if you can't find anything else, just find out how it changed kind of the culture of Hollywood, because, you know, that's when everybody started retreating from public places, stars, you know, putting walls up, buying guard dogs. They didn't feel safe in their homes anymore. That didn't interest me either, but I thought, all right, I need the money. But what I did was I read Helter Skelter, and then I interviewed Vince Bugliosi first, spent about 6 hours at his house. He was very generous with me, talked and talked and talked, said a couple things that are too complicated to explain in an interview. It would take like a half hour, but if you read the book, it takes chapters, and it's not till the very end you realize why it's so important. A couple right. lies he told me. But after that, he basically told me everything I'd already read him, he'd said to other interviewers for mm-hmm. years and years. I thought, why don't I reach out to people who've never talked about the case, principal witnesses? Because at the time, people really were frightened of the Manson family members on the outside. So the prosecution witnesses, the guy that owned the Tate LaBianca, the guy that owned the Tate house that rented it to him, has always been pursued by journalists because he's never talked about his pivotal part in all this. Terry Melcher, Doris Day's son, who also was connected to Manson.
Right.
So I, with the passage of time, I thought maybe they won't be as frightened. You know, maybe people who wouldn't talk will. So first, actually, I reached out to people like Sharon Tate and Roman Polanski's crowd. You know, they were very close friends to dozens of Hollywood people, but most close to Robert Evans, the producer, Ally McGraw, with Michelle Phillips, John Phillips of the Mamas and the Papas, Warren Beatty, Jane Fonda, Roger Vadim, none of them would talk to me. No one would talk to me. And it started getting really frustrating. And then I went to the witnesses, people who actually were lesser known except in the Hollywood industry. And I got a couple to agree to talk to me. And I realized it wasn't that they were less scared, but nothing had really happened to them since then. A lot of them, their lives went off the rails being associated with this, especially this one guy, Rudy, who owned the house where the murders happened, and he was a principal prosecution witness for Bugliosi. He had to testify about Manson having this visit to the house before the murders to establish that Manson knew where these people lived and how to get into the property. And Rudy had lost his life savings. He had owned that house, kind of became a drug addict, went through everything, had to sell the house to Trent Reznor of the Nine Inch Nails, and was living in a shitty, like, garage apartment in Van Nuys.
What year did he sell the house to Trent Reznor?
I think he owned it for 20 years after the murders. Okay. So that would be 79, 89, okay, maybe about around then. And he had a longtime business partner who was his lover. That guy had died. And he was being kept alive, and his bills were paid by an interesting group of his former clients. He was a talent manager. Dick Van Dyke, Jack Nicholson, Jimmy Darren, who was a kind of a pop singer, actor, and Sally Kellerman. So they would give him allowance because they all felt so sorry for him.
Wow.
So I started trying to get him to talk to me. And first he wanted me to pay him, and you're not allowed to pay people. I said, I'll just take you out to a really nice meal. That's the best I can do. So we went to the famous Musso and Frank restaurant, which if you saw Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, it's where Al Pacino's character has his first big dinner with Brad Pitt and Leonardo DiCaprio. It's a classic Hollywood movie location restaurant. So that turned into weekly dinners for about 2 or 3 years. And
Weekly for two or three years.
I mean, because he was lonely.
Right.
After the very first dinner, when he was driving home, he said he was chased off the road, got in a car accident, was almost killed. He thought that it was because he talked to me. Everything did happen. He did have an accident. Somebody hit him and ran. He did have to go to the hospital. I tried not to get paranoid. Nobody ever did again. He got notes and stuff from people telling him to stop talking to me. But the point being, he didn't have enough money to buy another car. So then I had to drive out there to Van Nuys from Venice, which is, he always wanted to go about 5 or 6 o'clock. So that meant a 2-hour drive with rush hour traffic. Then he always wanted to go out at swank places in Hollywood. So that's another rush hour traffic, could be 45 minutes. We get to a restaurant and he wouldn't order food for 2 hours because he wanted to have all his martinis or gin and tonics. And the next thing you know, he's grabbing the waiter's asses. He was a real character and he got away with it. But and then I'd have to, on the way home, stop at the supermarket at midnight. And I didn't pay for his groceries, but walk with him through the store, and it took forever. So it was like an 8-hour investment.
Jeez.
And I had to drive all the way back to Venice. But he was giving me information. And that's how you get it, you know. You have to really kind of embed yourself into people's confidence and lives.
Right.
And he was the first, and then there was like dominoes. Because people knew he was talking to me, more people talked to me. But it doesn't happen overnight. So that's when the story changed and evolved into something that wasn't going to be a magazine story anymore. My editor-in-chief of Premiere became obsessed with what I was finding. So he kept extending my deadline. He said, we don't need to do it for the anniversary. This is too important. So I think they paid me for a year and a half, a monthly salary, just to report the story. Then that editor-in-chief got fired, and I went to my editor who worked under him, and I said, please tell me Jim didn't get fired because of all the money that he had spent, like, I think $150,000, not just on my salary, but on my expenses for dinners and stuff. And I would phone to London to interview people. She said it didn't help. So a new editor was hired, and I got a call the next day from that him, and he said, sounds like you got a really exciting story there. I go, I hope so. He goes, well, I'm really going to be proud to publish it, and I'm slating it for the issue after the next. I go, I can't finish it. Jim would have told you. He goes, no, Jim's not here anymore. He goes, you got to have it in. So at that point, I got a book agent. And I didn't want to put out what I had because there were so many loose ends. And I thought, once I put out the most important stuff, you know, the LA Times, maybe I was grandiose, the New York Times, they're going to put their teams on this and they're going to get
the
goods.
They're going to finish it,
right? Yeah. So my agent got me out of my contract with a caveat that I had to reimburse, blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. So
definitely the right thing to do.
Yeah. Yeah. So at that point, well, sometimes I wonder, because the next thing I knew, you know, I didn't sell the book for another 5 years. In 2005, I sold the proposal, but I got an enormous, it was going to go to auction. So they, publisher Penguin Press gave me a, what's called a preemptive bid, which is higher than they'd normally pay. But for, I think it was 48 hours, nobody else could try to sell, make a deal with me. Mm-hmm. And if I didn't take their offer in 48 hours and they would withdraw, then it would go to auction.
Okay.
So I said, yes. My agent said they're really the best publisher in the business. You know, they do like presidential memoirs and they're boutique and powerful. And just publishing with them is going to give your crazy conspiracy book complete legitimacy. So I did. And they gave an advance that was like record breaking for somebody who had never written a book before. I'd just been a magazine journalist. And that looked like it was going to be a real happy ending. But then they got impatient in 2011, and long story short, they canceled the deal. And worse, they then sued me for a return of the advance, which had been spent by me on all my reporting. So from 2012 to about 14 or 15, everything was frozen. I couldn't go out and try to sell the book until the lawsuit was resolved. Right. I had to get a pro bono lawyer. So I just kept reporting as if I was going to have something.
How are you paying your bills?
I was living, borrowing money and living off of what little was left from the advance. Okay. But I lived very frugally. I mean, I'd done it in New York for years. You know, I was a struggling journalist. I drove a horse and carriage in Central Park for 8 years. I knew how to hustle.
Okay.
But I didn't have any real full-time job. During that period, because I worked 7 days a week researching. So once the lawsuit was resolved in 2016, I think, or 15, I got Dan as a collaborator, and we revised my book proposal. The original book proposal was book length. It was 220 pages. In fact, when Ann and Scott, the two people at Penguin Press, bought it, they said, you know, you've written the book. All you have to do is fill in some of the guts. This is the guts. Just fill in some of the stuff. And I'm like, yeah, easier said than done. They're still reporting. Mm-hmm. So once I got this wonder kid on, and only because Prince died. If Prince hadn't died, he would have been working with Prince for 3 more years. Prince died, and all of a sudden, his agent said to my agent, you know, I heard you're looking for someone. Dan would be perfect for this. He can't pick up the Prince thing for at least 2 years. Until that estate is figured out, because they were all fighting over whatever Prince, you know, his money, his future projects. So Dan had like 2 years off, and he and I turned it out in 2 years.
Wow.
And it came out literally, we turned in the final draft. I mean, after all the edits and notes from the publisher, the day before what would have been the 20th anniversary of the magazine assignment. So it was literally 20 solid years.
That's incredible, yeah, man. Yeah. That's incredible.
But I don't advise anybody to do that. It took off 40 years of my life. It was brutal. I mean, you keep thinking it's going to end and it doesn't. And the scariest thing is if the book had never come out.
Yeah.
That would have been, I would have been the tragic figure who, you know, spent his whole life writing a book and then never publishing his book. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, now I feel like if I got run over by a bus today, that's fine.
Yeah.
This is still here.
Right.
So.
Right. Yeah. You achieved your goal. You got, you got it out.
Yeah.
And you can wash your hands, but you're still, you know, obviously going to put out more.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
It's not going to take 20 years this time.